Okay, so in this video, I thought we'd take a little detour and look at an interesting model that was just released in the past few days. And this is, as far as I know, the first open source text to video. Now, what I'm showing you on the screen is actually not the model yet. This is one of the original diffusion text to video models called Image Gen Video. This came out of Google. And you see, this is pretty amazing when it first came out that you could actually take a input of a teddy bear running in New York City, and it could generate a video of that, or an elephant under the sea, or ice cream melting, or things in snow and stuff like that. So Google released this a few months back, probably late last year from memory. They also had another team that released Fanaki, which is a different kind of model in the way that it works. This can actually do sort of longer videos. They can go right out to 2 minutes, but each way has its own advantages. But this brings us to the model that was released in just the past few days. So this, as I understand it, comes from Alibaba. And as far as I know, this is the first open source text to video model that we can actually get our hands on and play with and try out and do a bunch of different things. And you can see that they've tried to reproduce some of the images from ImageGen. Some work out really well. As you'll see when we walk through the code, some maybe not so well. But it's fantastic that we can actually try this out and see how it's done. So as far as I know, there is no paper for this. I think they've just done it. Maybe there is a paper coming, which is quite possible. They have a little bit of detail in here about the training. So they've trained on the Lion 5B or 5 billion data set. They've trained on ImageNet and WebVid. So definitely the Lion one here is the big one. And there are some challenges with that data set. You will see in some of the images, et cetera, there are watermarks for things like Shutterstock or other image companies in there. So that's not ideal, but at least we've got something to play with. So Hugging Face has converted this, or someone's converted this to the Hugging Face Diffusers format. The Diffusers library is a very nice library from Hugging Face, which allows you to do diffusion model. Obviously, the most famous diffusion model would be stable diffusion. I'm guessing most of you know what that is. I may do another video explaining with code how the latent diffusion models work and how you can pull them apart and mess with them and a lot of the cool things that have been happening with them recently. But Diffusers allows us to do a lot of that, and it makes it quite easy. So someone's uploaded this and made it available. And I think someone at Hugging Face has converted it into Diffusers and put out a notebook. I've taken their notebook. So this is their original book if you want to play with it. And I've just modified it a bit just to pull apart the model so we can have a look at how it's working and what's going on a bit. So you'll need to install the dependencies. This is one of the first things that we've looked at that's actually using PyTorch 2. Actually, some of the previous notebooks, I think, may have had problems if you were running with PyTorch 2. So we're going to be in that little bit of limbo where we've got two versions of things going on for probably the next couple of months. All right. So the first thing is setting up the actual pipeline. So in a similar way to the Transformers libraries, the Diffusers library uses a pipeline. And this pipeline can take care of each of the steps in the process of the latent diffusion. And in this case, obviously converting it to video as well. So you can see that we've got the normal diffusion pipeline, which you could use for stable diffusion, something like that. But there's also new stuff there, like export to video. Obviously, we're bringing in this pre-trained model. Amazingly, the model is not that big. It's only 1.7 billion parameters, which compared to some of the other models that we've been looking at recently is actually quite small, especially if considering everything that it's doing in here. So it will take a little bit to just load the model. If we look at the model, so this is where this notebook differs from the Hugging Face one that I referred to before. If we start pulling apart the model and we start looking at it, because that's the thing that I'm interested in, is seeing, okay, how similar is this to other diffusion models that are out there? What's different in here? That kind of thing. So we can see that it's pretty standard stuff, right? We've got a variational autoencoder. So that's what sort of does the downsizing and upsizing in these. We've got a text encoder. So this is what takes the text and then converts it into a representation, an embedding or a set of embeddings that can be fed into the model. And actually they get fed into the UNet. So the UNet is another key part. So this is, again, this is a stock standard thing from the latent diffusion models like stable diffusion and stuff like that have this. And then they have the scheduler for doing the actual number of diffusion steps and how to calculate the steps, etc. So there's actually not a lot of stuff in here. We've got a tokenizer. If we look at the tokenizer, we can see that, okay, it does seem like there's a decent vocabulary size in here. One thing that we see here with this max length 77 and also in the text encoder is that you're limited to your description for the video to be 77 tokens long. So it's not very long. So that's pretty similar. I think it's maybe exactly the same to stable diffusion. So this starts to tell us that, oh, okay, this is probably built in a very similar kind of way. And sure enough, when we look at the text encoder, we can see that they're using the stock standard clip text model here. So this is what's taking the text in and then generating the embeddings out. And we can see that the embeddings that are coming out are 77 tokens long. We can see that a little bit about what's going on in that model if we wanted to pull that apart. This is kind of good to just get a sense of like, okay, this is doing the same thing that the normal stable diffusion would be doing. If we look at the UNet, we see a lot of similar things in that we see the normal sort of UNet where you've got your encoder and decoder. So you're going down. So we've got these down blocks going along, and then probably coming up the other side, we're going to have up blocks. I'm going to see what they're calling them. There are some differences in here. Let me see. Okay, so there's a bunch of down blobs there. Later on, I'm going to imagine that this, yes, we're doing the upsampling on the other side. So we've got the cross attention, which is another similar thing from stable diffusion of going on. But one thing that if we look at this, that's quite different is we've got this sort of 3D convolutions going on. So this is what's taking in the time steps element here. So obviously for making a video compared to making an image, we have to be thinking about multiple frames. And we can see that in the way this is handled. And notice another thing looking at it, we've got temporal convolutions going on. So we've got these temporal convolution layers. These are the things that are handling making the various frames as you go through this. So you could certainly come in here and have a play with this and look more in depth at what each of the layers is actually doing. But apart from that, it's basically a standard UNet that we've got there. So this sort of covers out each of the things that we've got going there. I think if we look to put the VAE, no, but you can go through and have a look at the VAE yourself. It's basically got a standard encoder and a decoder. So for downsizing to get us to the latent space, and then the upsizing of that latent space to get back to something that's a decent sort of image size. All right, once we've got that done, it's pretty basic. We're now just going to pass the text in. This is going to go into the clip embedding and generate a set of embeddings to come out. And then they're going to be passed through this UNet. And this UNet will inject some noise in there. And anytime you see one of these, the attention modules in here, let me just find one for you here. You can see these attention models. These will be taking in those embeddings as well. So you will pass the embeddings through to different parts of the UNet to keep it consistent over time as it's generating out there. So we can see this, all these sort of cross attention areas that are going on. I've set it up so that you can play around with the negative prompt yourself in here. And then we're basically just going through and in the pipeline here, we're just passing in the prompt, the negative prompt, the number of inference steps, and the number of frames that we actually want for this to generate out. And you can see I've gone for some of the same prompts that were used in the image gen video here. If we come and look here, we can see that, okay, our video of a teddy bear running in New York is certainly a teddy bear running, whether it's New York or not, certainly on a road, and you can go and play with this. Now, one of the big disadvantages of this model, I think I mentioned before, is you can see the Shutterstock logo right across there. So the model has learned that over a lot of images. Now, obviously this is a big legal issue as well as being an annoyance to us, but it's still interesting to check this out. Next one, panda eating bamboo on a rock. If we play around with this, this is definitely a panda. It looks like in a zoo enclosure and it appears to be eating bamboo, right? And I guess that's a rock behind it. Maybe it's on a big rock there as well. So it's pretty amazing that you could just come and type anything in here and generate it out. Now, some of them, these two were generated first time. This next one I generated a few times to try getting it something looking better. So this is a drone flying through a tropical jungle covered in snow. So let me just bring this back to the start. And this is doing a fly through. So you can see that there are the trees with snow on it. Perhaps not the best generation in that. Now, because there's a seed, there's a unique seed going in each time. Each time you generate it, it's a random seed. You will get a different image out or a different little mini video out. So that's something that you can play with and try here. Clownfish swimming through a coral reef. This one seemed to work straight out of the box. This is a really nice video. Again, we've got the shutterstock element going on there, which is not ideal. I do wonder, it's amazing that it's on so many of these videos. Was it intentional or not? I don't think so. But we've got clownfish going on there. And look at even things like the coral, it's got that really well. It's got the sense of being underwater, etc. And the last one I did was this robot dancing in Times Square. So this one definitely looks like a robot. It looks like it could be Times Square, perhaps even Shinjuku in Tokyo, but it's pretty out there. And it's amazing just how well it's taken that prompt and turned it into a video. So anyway, I thought this would be a little nice sort of deviation away from some of the things that we've been looking at with large language models, in that this is using elements. The clip model is obviously taking text and generating embeddings to use for vision and stuff like that. But have a play with it. Just see for yourself how well this works, what you can do with it. Try it out, make some little clips, see what's the most interesting thing that you can make. I think going forward, I will do some videos on some of the generative AI art models and looking at some of the computer vision models. There's a lot of interesting things there. We're also seeing a lot of overlap between these models and some of the language models are now starting to have things that are crossing over. So it does make sense, I think, for you to understand how each of them work and what the key parts of each of them are, so that as you start to see these things pop up in different places, you understand what's going on. Anyway, as always, if you have any questions, please put them in the comments. And if this was useful to you, please click like and subscribe. I will see you in the next video. Bye for now.